Hit the video record.
So I'm Darlene Furdock. I teach world languages and English language learners here at Middlesex Community College. I'm, you know, calling one of the things I've done since our trip to Cambodia, Killing Fields, How People Heal. At first, the only thing, you know, a long time ago, the only thing I knew about Cambodia was the Killing Fields, the book, the movie. Then about 10 years after the Khmer Rouge period, I began teaching ESL here at Middlesex Community College, and a large percentage of my classes were survivors, and I would hear their stories. And a lot of the time, they would sort of rebel at learning English grammar. They said, our language doesn't have grammar. And that was only because they really had an interrupted education. I also thought that surely, once I've taught these refugees English, my job's going to dry up, but we've continued to have immigrants from Cambodia and other parts of the world, what was a gateway city. So kind of just briefly an overview, what I want to do is talk about how some of the in-country experiences influenced me, and also how do you introduce contemporary Cambodian culture to students. How do you present the Khmer Rouge period, 1975 to 1979, and how have survivors of that period responded to their experience? So in country, one of the most important aspects of our trip, and it was a special opportunity, we met so many contemporary leaders in Cambodia, and I was so impressed by all the individuals we had a chance to spend time with. And one of the first people we saw and met was Yuk Chang, who is the director of the Documentation Center of Cambodia. He spent a lot of time with us. It was just a wonderful experience. And I was wildly taking notes. I was impressed by how beautiful our surroundings were. And I took a lot of pictures as we were going through the center. But there were a couple of things he said that stuck with me. One thing was when he was talking about his background, just the emotion and the way he said it, they killed my sister. And I could understand why he had devoted the rest of his life to seeking justice for what had happened in his family. Another thing, just talking about where we were and what we were seeing, he mentioned art heals. And you know, there were a lot of takeaways from our time with him, but those were two things that stayed with me. We also had the chance to spend time with Arn Torn Pond. We had read a book, Never Fall Down, about his life. We got to go to his home. He mentioned how when they were building the house, they found fragments of bombs. We also saw that a guitarist with his group had lost part of his nose, had been disfigured when his aunt was carrying him during the carpet bombings. Mm-hmm. And one thing that stayed with me that Arn said was, Cambodia was carpeted by bombs. I want to carpet Cambodia with music. So he's the founder of Cambodian Living Arts and the Magic Music Bus. And we had, as we've already seen, experience with both of those organizations. I also, had a very kind of moving experience seeing Chun Mei. We had seen him here in Lowell before, the author of Survivor, and actually having a firsthand narration of what it was like to be in Tuol Sleng prison. So we had so many rich experiences, but initially we had the experience of knowing what the Khmer Rouge period was like. Before I went, I knew I wanted to integrate some knowledge about contemporary Cambodian culture into my class. I wanted to increase an awareness of contemporary Cambodian culture. But also, I have the duty to do what I'm supposed to do academically in my class, to practice and improve reading and writing skills, and have my students exercise critical thinking skills. This was in a class that's given for bilingual students who are just pre-English composition. So how do you present the Khmer Rouge period, 1975 to 1979? I didn't want my students students, you know, who may not know a lot about genocide, to think that this was a unique experience to Cambodia, or that it defined who the Cambodian people were. So the first thing I did, even before I spoke about Cambodia, was to teach them about the Milgram experiment. And if you're not familiar with it, it was a series of experiments, but Stanley Milgram was a Jewish American psychology professor at Yale, and he was thinking during the Nuremberg trials, the Germans kept giving the excuse for participating in the Holocaust, I was following orders. So he thought he was going to prove that Germans have a stronger disposition to following orders than the rest of us. So he set up an experiment, so sort of briefly, that the subjects thought that they were part of a teaching learning experiment, how people learn, but in fact it was an experiment to find out how obedient people were. So the subjects had two actors, one was a researcher, the other was supposed to be a learner, and the subject thought he was a teacher, teaching a student in another room. Whenever the student gave a wrong answer, and the student would deliberately give a wrong answer, he was supposed to deliver electric shocks. So prior to the experiment, most of the psychologists at Yale thought, oh, surely not more than 4% of the subjects will harm the learners. In fact, all of the subjects harmed the learners, actually delivered electric shocks. They weren't. He was an actor, the learner, but he would be screaming and protesting. So the subject actually thought he was delivering electric shocks up to the maximum of, 450 volts, at least 350 volts. If you think about a regular electric outlet, that's like 110 volts. So that was pretty dangerous. The outcome, sort of the conclusion from the experiments was that ordinary people are likely to follow and obey orders given by an authority figure, even to the extent of killing an innocent human being. So, and the experiment was reproduced about 18 times with some variations. It's been done in different cultures, and even in a place like Jordan, with largely the same results. But I have a hyperlink there. What I did was have the students read an article. In the hyperlink, there are also videos of the subjects in the original experiment. So students, you know, learned about that and wrote a formal summary and a response essay. At the same time, I wanted them to sort of not just be memorizing facts. I wanted them to think about things and exercise critical thinking. So I devised a lot of exercises around that. I also have a hyperlink here. I didn't really want to focus on genocide. What I did was use part of a documentary done for CNN by Christiane Amanpour. One segment of her documentary deals with the Khmer Rouge period. And I showed students the video of that. They viewed the documentary and discussed it and wrote about it. But in devising the exercises, I wanted to be sure I wasn't just feeding them information. I wanted them to think about it. So I found a resource. National Geographic uses this resource. They say it's their go-to resource when they're trying to devise lesson plans. So I have a hyperlink for that too, and it's what it is. It's the ultimate cheat sheet for critical thinking, and it has kind of the question words, you know, who, what, where, when, why, how, and about 8 questions that begin with those question words that you can apply to almost any subject. So what I did, for example, with the Milgram experiment, I devised questions like, I told the students, these are some questions to ponder. What are your answers? And they had to write about it. Like, why is this Milgram experiment relevant to me or to others? Who benefits from this? When is this acceptable or unacceptable? How does this benefit or harm us or others, and why should people know about this? And so they use those as part of their guide to writing a formal summary and response essay. And then what I did, you know, they had had sort of an idea that, well, ordinary people, anybody could end up doing this. It could happen anywhere. And that, you know, they had an idea of what had happened in Cambodia, not overly focusing on it, but had an idea through Christiane Amanpour's documentary. And I used the two people I had met in Cambodia, Yuk Chang and Arntorn Pond. I found articles about them. The article about Yuk Chang had been associated with the documentary Scream Bloody Murder that Christiane Amanpour had produced. And then the article, and so basically it was how he had created the Documentation Center, or helped create, and was the director of the Documentation Center of Cambodia, and how they had been seeking justice. The article I found about Arntorn Pond was in the Guardian, the British Guardian, and its title was Why the Arts Are as Important as Hospitals in Cambodia. And it was, you know, it really talked about the importance of the arts and in present day Cambodia, how they're spreading the arts, and it's a healing factor in that culture. Mm-hmm. There also was an associated link. I found out that Arntorn Pond had done a short TED talk recently, and where he tells about his life and plays the flute. I was also able to supplement these articles and videos with my own photos that I took in Cambodia. And like it really amused my students to see me on the magic music bus or, you know, there at the house taking a picture of Arntorn Pond. So it brought it to life from them. And actually his TED talk is called Music Saved My Life. So, you know, all along I developed a lot of materials to use with these articles and videos. And the final culminating project was that they were supposed to, and they did, synthesize all of the information. They were to write an essay discussing the ways in which individuals and a society who have suffered a trauma, such as genocide, can heal. And as support, they used the articles about Yuk Chang and Arntorn Pond, the associated videos, as well as their personal experiences, opinions, and observations. And just as an instructor here in Lowell, inevitably, in every class, I have a refugee or an immigrant who has suffered a really traumatic experience. So when I was using these materials last fall, there was a young woman in my class whose family had, she'd had quite a journey from the Democratic Republic of the Congo and the genocide that happened there to the west coast of Africa and Cote d'Ivoire, and finally to Lowell, Massachusetts. And she was able to talk about how these things happen and what it's like to live through that experience. And this semester I had a woman, an older student from Somalia, who she shared that when she was just 10 years old, in the middle of the night, they came for her brothers and the other male members of her family. And that was all she said, but it was enough for us to understand why she subsequently became a refugee in Canada and then finally ended up in the United States. So I think it helps my students understand their classmates and the city they're living in and working in and studying in. And I've been able to do other things. It was such a rich experience. But this is just one of the things I've been able to develop from our